to stand still. And they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. And when they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught Philip away, that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went his own way rejoicing. So the only purpose Philip was to go to the desert was to take the gospel to this Ethiopian. It's the only reason. No other purpose. Because once he went there and he done what God wanted him to do, God took him away. That was the only purpose. And why is this so important? Because that's the end of verse 8. Verse 9 starts about Saul, who was killing, right? Verse 9 starts the conversion of Paul. So, what did the scripture say? Salvation is to the Hebrew first, then the Gentile. So before God could release Paul, I know y'all with me. Before God can release Paul to take the gospel to the Gentiles, he had some more Hebrews down in Africa that hadn't heard it yet. So he had to get the message to this eunuch who was on his way back to take the gospel back to Africa before he released Paul to go to the Gentiles. See that? You got another perspective? Yes. Then Paul is released. Paul is on the Damascus Road. And he is knocked off his mule, his horse, whatever he was riding, and blinded. And he said, "Paul, Paul, why are you persecuting me?" This was the Spirit of Christ talking to him. Okay? This was the Holy Spirit talking to Paul, preparing Paul to go on his mission of taking the gospel to the Gentiles. And Paul did that. But before Paul can do it, God had to get this gospel to another region. Amen? Before he could release Paul. That's why I say, we're not Gentiles. The gospel, the Bible has witnessed to us twice now that we're not Gentiles. Paul went to the Gentiles. Okay, now, let me show you something else. You guys still got that map in the back of your book? Yeah. I want to show you something. Paul went to the Gentiles, right? His message to the Gentiles. His mission was to the Gentiles. Now, Paul wrote a third of the Bible. He wrote what? Corinthians? Colossians, Galatians, Philippians, Ephesians. Those of you who have the Bible with the map in the back, go to that same map where we were looking at before. And you may not see it all right now while I'm talking, but I don't want you to just drop this. I want you to look at it in your spare time so you can find each and every one of them. All these books that Paul wrote, Ephesians, Philippi, Colossians, Thessalonians, all these places are cities. Did you know that? Yeah, these are cities that Paul went to. And you can see all those cities on this map. Some of the maps will show with a color the journeys of Paul. And look at the one that says the journey to Rome. And you will see he went to Rome over there. Now, also you can see, I see the city of Corinth, which is Corinthians. Right there where it says Macedonian, you go down, you'll see Corinth. And right there where it says Macedonian, you go over to the right, you'll see the word Philippi. And then right down from Philippi, you see Thessalonica. Then you go over to your right, and you can see the city of Ephesus, which is Ephesians. Then you go over and you can see the region of Galatia, which is the Galatians. And then right down in the middle there's Colossae, which is the Colossians. There are seven cities. There are seven books in the Bible that Paul wrote. These are cities that Paul went to take the gospel to the Gentiles. I told you that's where the Gentiles are. That's what God told us. This is where Paul went. Okay, why is there not a book of Mali? How about a book of Ghana? A book of the Congo? A book of Tanzania? Why not? Paul didn't go there. And why didn't he go there? There's no Gentiles there. I'm trying to show you. There's no Gentiles there. Say what? He was sent to the Gentiles. And he finished his course. Paul obeyed God. He did exactly what God wanted him to do. He went exactly where God wanted him to go. But he didn't go to Africa. Why? You think God didn't care about them? No, God had already taken care of them with the eunuch. He had already taken care of them. The gospel was on his way down there. Because, see, they already had a form. They already had a lifestyle. Because they was at the mountain. Now, I'm not saying all Africans are Hebrews. See, don't misunderstand me. Just like the Bible said, you know, Jew and Gentile. So everybody think now you're either one or the other. Now, because I'm saying we are not Gentile does not mean we're Jews. Only those that was there and said yes to the Lord were Hebrews. Even today, you can go to the farthest reaches in Ethiopia, and there are tribes, there's communities of people that still live like the biblical people lived. They worship like the biblical people worshipped. Back in 19, when was that? They did two excursions. Back in the early, I mean the 1990s, they did two, no, in the 80s, I'm sorry, the 80s. 80s and the early 90s. The Hebrew people, you guys remember when Russia was over in Ethiopia and they was killing and they had war, they was capturing all the men and women, and there was news reports of their thousands of women and children marching across the desert, going to refugee camps. Just women and children. Because all the men were either dead or gone. And Israel put together a mission. They didn't ask NATO, the United Nations. They didn't ask permission, nobody. They put together a mission, and they called it Operation Moses. And they went and airlifted all those women and children up out of there and brought them to Israel. They did it twice. Operation Moses. So you see, because you're not Hebrew does not necessarily mean, I mean, I'm not saying every African is a Hebrew. What I'm saying is there's no African that is a Gentile. I am saying that. Because God has already showed us where the Gentiles are. Amen. Now, Paul, on his missions, when he went to these cities, he discussed with them the kingdom of God concerning Jesus Christ. And he took the gospel to them. Now, I'm sure there were a lot of Africans that was there in Europe that was receiving these things. But for the most part, and I can't say it enough, Paul never went to Africa. He never took this gospel to Africa. Because we are not Gentiles. That's the big lie. that Satan has told us. Why were we lied to so much, so bad, so big? I'm going to tell you why. Remember what Moses said to Jethro? Come and lead us. Be our eyes. Oh. Be our eyes in the wilderness. Be our eyes in the darkness. We are the eyes of the church. We are the eyes of the church. The world imitates us on every level. First, they ridicule what they see us do, and then it's acclimated into their society. They used to talk about our big lips. Now they're getting collagen. They used to talk about our slang. Now they're speaking it. They used to talk about our dress, and now they're dressing it. They used it in each island, okay, and now they're eating them. We are the eyes. See, the children of Israel back at that time, that was the essence of the church. The children of Israel. But on this side of the cross, it's called the church. We're Christians. But you think God has changed? Has he changed? No, he said, I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. His purpose, his design, his plans will last forever. We are the eyes. Spiritually, you know, there's, I'm reminded of, you know, in the African culture, they're ridiculed a lot, and I'm not taking up for them, but because I know there's a lot of truth to it, but they're ridiculed a lot because of their spirituality. You know, their dances, their spells, their roots, and their idol worshiping, and things like that. Like I said, I'm not defending them because there's a lot of truth to that. But another perspective is how spiritual they are. They are spiritual. They are aware that there is something. You see? Now, they may be misled, but there is something. I'm reminded of when I was doing the T-shirt business, African Kings and Queens. One of the kings that and queens that we portrayed was Akhenaten and his wife Nefertiti. And Akhenaten, when he became Pharaoh, he tore down every idol in Egypt because he had a revelation that there was only one God. You didn't know that, huh? He had a revelation that there was only one God. And he put up an image. The image of the God was a son. He created a son image. Now, like I said, I'm not defending, you know, them, but I'm looking at the aspect of the pattern of what was done. He created an image of the son, made an image of the son, and him and Nefertiti stood up under the son. And the son had rays. And the rays, one of the rays had a long arm with a hand. In the hand was a spoon, and the spoon was feeding him. And another one was feeding her. Now, this was idol worship. But look at the concept. One God, and he's feeding me. One God, and he's feeding me. See, a lot of times we look at these things, oh, that's voodoo, that's witchcraft, that idol worship, and I don't want to see it, I don't want to hear that. But get another perspective. Remember I was telling you, Pastor, we've got to be able to see further than we can look. to see further than we can look. I told that story at my sister. I just buried my sister last week, and I told that story. And I know I'm getting long. I'm gonna get up from in front of you here, but there was a little boy standing outside looking up in the sky, and his father come out and says, "What you looking at?" He said, "Look, Dad, do you see it?" And his dad looked up. He said, "See what?" He said, "Dad, you don't see it?" Dad said, "I'm looking, son, but I don't see it." See, that's the end of the story. But the moral is this. Especially we who call ourselves Christians, we who are called by his name, we who live the lifestyle he has given us, we who claim to have discernment, we have to see further than we can look. See, when I look at you, I can't just look at you at your torn jeans and that Rams is on your shirt and your color of your boots. I've got to be able to see beyond this and see the God in you. See the spirit that is influencing you and moving you. See your heart. Understand your personality. Know that no matter what I see, you're created in the image of God. You see, regardless of what the enemy, the devil, wants me to focus on, I got to see beyond that. I got to see that the Spirit of God dwells in you. And do whatever it takes, whatever I can, by the leading of the Holy Ghost, to expound on that. To nurture that, to help that to grow, to bring that forth. So that which the enemy is trying to manifest on the outside takes a back seat. Amen? I'm going to close with this. Bishop Tudor, who's a good friend of mine and mentor, told me a story once. I'm going to try to relate it to you as I go to my seat, and I hope I do it justice. He said there was a lady that had twins, and one of the twins was sickly and weak, and one was strong, and she struggled with these boys. They taxed her a lot. And one day, someone came along and said they would help her, that they would take the boys off her hands and help her. And she said, no, I can't give up my boys. And they said, well, we just want to help. And she said, well, where are you going to take them? And they described to her, it was a place afar off. She said, no, I can't give up my boys. But as she thought about it, looking at her boys and how she struggled, she told them, okay, I'll let you do it, but only one. They said, just one? Yeah, only one. Take the strong one. And they said, really, why not the weak one that we can really help him? She said, the weak one won't make the journey. The weak one won't make the journey. But take the other one. He's strong enough to make the journey. I'll keep the weak one and do my best. So the strong one took the journey across an ocean. To a far off land called America. And now that strong one has waxed large. Has grew. Become strong. Oh, he endured a lot. Abuse. Hardship. Struggled. Oh, it wasn't easy. He struggled a lot. But he was the strong one. And he survived. And now, he has become large in America. And the weak one remained in Africa. Look at what God has done. Look at what God has done. It's a God thing. It was the work of the Lord. It was the work of the Lord. Amen. Amen. I hope you got something out of this today. I hope it blessed you. For Father God, I just thank you now, Lord God, as I've done the best I could, Lord God, to relate this information to your people, Lord God, to bring illumination, to bring understanding, Lord God, to open up your word in another way, Lord God, that they may see that they are all in your history. They are all in your plan. That we as a people are very instrumental in your purposes. Very important to your purposes. And we thank you, Lord. We give you praise. We give you honor, Lord God. We give you glory. And God, I pray we never look at scriptures the same way. That we begin to dig, to look, to ask questions. To not just accept what society has told us, but to look into your word and see what your report is. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Oh, sure. Sure. Yes. On this particular thing, I don't have a book, but it's funny you should ask that. I just finished the book, and I'm working on part two. In fact, I gave a book to Apostle Conley to read just this week to give me a comment on the book before I go to publish. But it's about some of these things, but it's a whole lot more. It's called Bridging the Gap. A journey from law to grace. And so on this particular topic, I don't have anything written, but I'm open to any questions. I'm transparent. I'm available. I'm reachable. I'm on the phone every day with people explaining, talking, taking them from precept to precept, concept to concept, opening understanding. So I don't have anything right now that I can give you except my phone number. And I'm always available. Anything else? Anyone else? Yes. How do I know that he didn't? Because they're still there suffering. The weak one is still suffering. Yeah, I'm glad you said that. The weak one is still there suffering. But see, but that brings up the question, am I my brother's keeper? The strong one, which is us, Do we not have an obligation to help our weak brother now that we have